Skylum, we have a tool.
This week, saddles for gaited horses.
Gaited horses are typically more developed in the shoulders, and they use their shoulders a little bit different.
With Oklahoma saddle maker Doug Ford.
Basically, you need a little more room in the front of a gaited horse saddle, but not so much in the back.
So get comfortable, kick your boots off, and join me. This is The Horse Show, and I'm Rick Lamb.
Studies have shown that the higher the body temperature, the quicker an athlete reaches fatigue. That's why pro football players use protective padding that's not only shock absorbing, but lightweight and breathable to allow heat dissipation. Now the same technology is available for your horse. Professional's Choice Air Ride saddle pads are designed with exactly the same material, which allows your horse to remain cool and performing at its maximum while effectively deflecting shock. Try the Air Ride today. Go to profchoice.com and click Rick Lamb.
When customers talk, Richie listens. And the Omni 10 automatic waterer has just what customers want. Extra size and strength, total heat coverage, large access panel, stainless steel trough, and Richie's famous fast refill valve. Like all Richie waterers, the Omni 10 is durable, reliable, and comes with a 10-year warranty. Learn more at richiefount.com. And relax, Richie waters them right.
Well, Doug, we know that horses psychologically are pretty much all the same, gaited horses, non-gaited horses, but gaited horses have some anatomical differences that a lot of people aren't even aware of compared to non-gaited horses, and that does affect their gait and how a saddle should be built. So can you explain to me how they differ?
If you start with a quarter horse, their backs have very much dip in them, and they're bred that way, and they're very flat toward the back of the saddle. They're very steep at the front of the saddle. So this is just the way they're made. And so therefore, what's happened in this country is that for 50 years, when there was only a couple of gaited horse breeds and nobody really built Western saddles for them, all the tree makers built trees to fit that market.
Yeah.
And so what's happened is that since so many gaited breeds have come on, the horses are made different. So now a gaited horse's back is going to be, gaited horses are typically more developed in the shoulders and they use their shoulders a little bit different. But basically you need a little more room in the front of a gaited horse saddle, but not so much in the back. So what needs to happen is if you take a regular tree, the tree is made of four pieces. So you have your two bars, which is the part that fits on the horse's back and that you sit on. And then you have the cantle in the back. On a Western saddle, it's technically it's called a swell. A lot of people call it a pommel or a fork.
It's this part right here.
Right, that's a fork or a swell. And on an English saddle, it'd be a pommel. But generally speaking, what needs to happen is this bar needs to change. On a Western saddle, this bar is going to be very flat back here, pretty steep up here, and not have much change. So this area here is called a twist in the bar.
Mm-hmm.
And so what needs to happen, it needs to change as it comes back to stay on the horse's back. Another condition that's built into the bar is called rock. And so that is a camber or a bend in the bar. So if you look at a quarter horse just standing real nice, you know, squared quarter horse, their back is going to have pretty much of a dip in it. So that's where this rock comes into play. Again, a gaited horse typically is not going to have that. And if they do, it's probably because they've been in a Western saddle that didn't fit them. And so what the horse does is he will drop his back to try to get away from the pressure of the rock or the bar.
And that'll affect how he goes, how well he can do his signature gait.
Well, it will affect not only that, it will affect his attitude.
Yeah.
And it will affect his general well-being because, again, horses' spine is like people. Everything kind of goes and comes from the spine. It's very important. So horses learn how to compensate.
Uh-huh.
And so what you'll see these horses, you'll see gaited horses with these big old dip backs. Well, that's a sign of one of two things. Either one, they are in a bad saddle, and or they're really being ridden with a lot of pressure in their face, and that's a show for another time.
So you can just look at a horse standing there, a gaited horse, and get a sense of whether his saddle fits him and whether he's being ridden correctly just from looking at how his back looks.
Absolutely, yeah. Especially if he's been under saddle very long.
Now this particular tree, is this one for a gaited horse?
Yes.
Okay, so it's got a little bit different twist to it.
Right.
And does the, what did you call the other part? Not the rock.
Yes, the rock would be an area right in here.
Okay, is that pretty much the same as with quarter horses, or is that a bit different
no,
as well?
No, there's a lot less rock and a lot less twist in a gaited horse.
So the whole thing, basically, the whole tree for a gaited horse should be completely different from a quarter horse tree. Fair statement?
Yes, very fair.
Okay.
So like this tree here, and you may not be able to tell that much difference, but this tree here is very flat back here.
Uh-huh.
And is more steep here. Not a lot steeper in the front, but it's a little steeper in the front and has a little more rock. And this one is not a severe one. So, I mean, a lot of the different, depending on what kind of quarter horse you're building for, you know, again, you still need to, even within the breed, you need to be fitting, you know, form to function.
Right. Individual differences.
Absolutely. And especially, you know, if you're trying to get to a very high level of development with your horse. So these saddles don't have to fit perfectly, but the closer you get, it's like shoes. You know, the analogy we like to use a lot is shoes. If your shoes fit good and they feel good, you can walk.
Right.
But if you're trying to go out hiking Sunday school shoes, you're probably not going very far.
Now this one appears to be, just this example here, appears to be some sort of hard rubber or plastic or
right.
something, which is not traditional. You've kind of stayed with the traditional wood trees. Why is that?
Well, again, this is something that we've studied a lot as we were getting into the saddle building and with no bias or prejudice toward or against any saddle. We wanted the ones that made the horses work best. And so what we found that, like this here is a flex tree. And as you can see right now, it's not very flexible, but that can change.
If it got warm, it might flex a little
bit. If it gets warm, the warmer it gets, the more it's going to flex. But if, let's say it worked perfectly. Mm-hmm. If it worked perfectly, when you're sitting in this tree, now you are starting to become the pressure point. So all your weight is going to be coming right into this one small area. It's going to bring the bars off of the front, put a lot of pressure on the back. The problem is that the bars, the job of the bar is to spread the weight of the saddle and everything in it up and down this bar as much as possible to keep the horse more comfortable. So ideally you want a long pressure spread down the bar, and then you can also add your skirt. This is another thing, when you add the skirt, Your skirt needs to come into the bar, and then what is not, so let me show you right here. You're going to have some extra, you're going to have your bar coverage,
mm-hmm.
and then you're going to have extra skirt that comes off over the bar.
Mm-hmm.
So when you do that, this is even going to give you some extra coverage. So this will, again, help
spread it out,
spread that pressure out.
So the entire purpose of the bar is sort of lost when it flexes, right? I mean, isn't the whole purpose of it to remain rigid and be a firm platform for spreading out all of that pressure?
Absolutely.
Okay.
And this is why I say we've studied flex. We've studied the flex panel, which is where they put the bolts front and back, put a little panel here, and it flexes. So now you got two pressure points. You got one here and here, severe pressure points. We've studied treeless. Treeless, you have seat bones.
Uh-huh.
And then not only do you have all this pressure going into one area, but now you got two little divots. Mm-hmm. And the thing, that the biggest complaint that I get with people trying to get them fit in their saddles is they getting pressure in their seat bones. Well, getting pressure in the seat bones, again,
in the human seat bone,
right,
it's uncomfortable
human,
for them.
Right.
Okay.
And if they learn how to sit right, that will take a lot of that pressure off of the horse's back. But if they're sitting in there digging into that horse's back, If you're digging into this tree, well, then that's nothing to the horse. Right. But if you're digging into his back, again, that back's going down.
Now, the other thing I noticed about this particular tree of yours is it seems to put the rider a little bit more in the middle, like the low point seems to be more in the middle, as opposed to this one. And we don't mean to pick on this particular manufacturer, but the low point is farther back. It's almost like you're being thrown back on your pockets.
Well, and this is not unusual. This is the way most trees are made. And so you got one of two options. You've got the option for the saddle maker. As a saddle maker, we're going to put a ground seat in every saddle we make. So that's like this tree here has the ground seat in it. Mm-hmm. So what we're going to do here, right, we're going to lay layers of leather. So you can see two right here.
Sure.
And I think there's another one even underneath this. We can look in here. This one's got four layers of leather. So what we've done is...
Let's turn that towards the camera. That is very interesting how all those layers of leather are built up there. And it looks like you almost kind of sand them down or something.
Well, we skive them. We have a tool where we actually take and we keep working this down. And we keep filling this with our hand. And as we move from one piece of leather to the other, we want this to stay perfectly smooth.
And that's called the ground seat.
This is a ground seat. Mm-hmm. And so you can take your ground seat and you can take a lot of that out or leave it in. A lot of people, again, they want what they think is the security of sitting way in the back of this saddle. The problem is that takes you out of balance with your horse. It takes you off of the horse's center of balance. And you're back here against this cantle. Well, you're back in here where you think it's nice and secure. And a lot of saddle builders will not only leave this down here, but they'll use our ground seat principle, build the front up even more and try to lock you in there. In our saddles, if you want to notice here, what we try to do is we try to build them more like a dressage saddle, where the saddle tends to send you from the back and the front to the middle. And so what we want is you sitting in the middle of the saddle with your balance in the horse's center of balance. And so that's, you know, where our saddle starts to differ from typical gaited saddles. And this is the reason that we really have a business. As far as we know, right now, we're the only company that deals in a gaited horse saddle that is built on balanced seat, balanced stirrups. The standard seat we're going to put...
Coming up next, building saddles for male and female riders.
How comfortable your seat is comes down to how you're built in the pelvic area.
And another nutrition nugget from ADM Alliance Nutrition.
So what you really want to do to get a handle on the cost of your horse feeding program...
Stay with us.
...is calculate the hay, weigh it out, figure out...
Go wild. Go super wild. Fly protection goes high fashion with the Super Mask 2 Horsefly Mask with Shimmerweave Mesh. Shimmerweave Mesh reflects your horse's natural color. Choose from four fabulous fashion-forward styles. Go wild with the Super Mask 2 Horsefly Mask with Shimmerweave Mesh Color Collection.
If you care enough about your horse to use Red Brand, the number one name in fencing, you'll want to make sure it looks great and lasts a long time. That's why Red Brand has created free installation videos available at redbrand.com. You'll find step-by-step instructions on every aspect of installation, post-basing, corner bracing, splicing, pulling, and tips and techniques used by the pros. There's even a handy fence calculator and a dealer locator. Get the very best in safety and security for your horse with 100% American-made Red Brand.
I was looking for a riding buddy, and ACTHA helped me find one.
Debbie used ACTHA's Find a Buddy program.
Nobody wants to ride alone. Find a Buddy is a great way to share the fun of trail riding and build a riding community.
Find a Buddy is a free service from ACTHA. Membership is not required. Visit ACTHA.us.
So, find a buddy.
And let's ride.
Build community with the American Competitive Trail Horse Association. ACTHA.us. Imagine a warehouse with everything for your horse. That's Jeffers Equine. Jeffers is the best equine catalog with more than 25,000 items, same day free shipping, the happiest customers, and the lowest prices guaranteed. Save big on a year's supply of apple flavored dewormers, just $29.99. Call 1-800-JEFFERS or visit jefferseequine.com to get your free catalog. Equine specialists are standing by. Jeffers Equine, earning your trust right here in America since 1975.
stirrup stretcher.
Oklahoma saddlemaker Doug Ford puts more than 40 years of experience with gaited horses into every saddle he builds. At his shop near Tulsa, my education continued.
Women and men are built differently. Hey, there's a profound thought. But it does make a difference sometimes in how the saddle is designed. Do you make any changes if you know it's going to a female rider?
We can. A standard seat, we're going to put just one layer of leather over our strainer plate, and we're going to smooth that out. And one of the jobs of this is to make sure there's no lumps, bumps, humps, ridges, flaws in this seat, because if there's a ridge, a flaw, bump,
you'll
or hump,
it.
After a while, you're going to start feeling it's going to hurt. So with a standard seat, we're just going to take one nice thick piece of leather. We're going to wet that thing, glue it in here, smooth it all up, and it's going to be fairly wide. A lot of women like that. How comfortable your seat is comes down to how you're built in the pelvic area.
Okay.
So if you're wider in the pelvic area, you're going to want a
kind of a delicate question to bring up to a
it
woman.
Is.
I said, just how wide are you, man?
After you talk about breeding, this is pretty
okay.
easy.
So, I guess you're right.
But what it comes down to is how you're built there. And yeah. So most men either want a standard or a medium seat.
Okay.
Most women either want a standard seat, or if they're really a small frame person, if they're very narrow in the pelvic area, then they're going to want what we would call a narrow seat.
Do you ever have the luxury of having them come in and actually sit in some saddles and you kind of look at what's going to work for them?
Absolutely, and that's we encourage people to do that, because if they'll come in and we put them in this seat, what we're going to do is we've got a top, just a regular saddle top like this. If their saddle's not already made, we'll take shims like these and we'll actually place them in the saddle, and then we'll put a top on the saddle like so.
Well, that's how you kind of build it up and
right.
See what.
So now we've simulated the seat of the saddle for the person, and they can sit in this thing, and we'll sit there and move these things around until we know about what they want. And
so they can feel that little thin piece.
Absolutely.
Wow.
It's amazing. Like this one, that's probably about 3 ounces.
Uh-huh.
So if I put you in this seat and I ask you how it feels, are you being spread out? Are you getting pressure? Are you getting pressure in your seat bones? All these, you know, I know the right questions to ask you to get you to give me the right answer so we can get this thing going. And so we'll move this. We might go from thicker to thinner. We might move it forward or back. But eventually, we're going to get this thing where you're pretty happy with it. And once we do that, then we just glue it down, mm-hmm. lock it in, and you've got a custom seat.
So the other half of that fitting question then, obviously, is how you fit the horse.
That's where the Duracast comes in. It comes in a box like this, and it has everything in here you need to cast the horse's back. The most important thing probably is that little DVD right there.
Instructions.
It tells you exactly how to do this thing.
And so the finished product comes out, as I understand it, looking like this. Is that correct?
That's correct.
And you can see that's fairly rigid there. There's not much
yep.
chance to go wrong once you've got one of these.
Typically, we can talk to you on the phone, ask you a few questions. And if you're giving me standard tree questions, just don't worry about it. If you're talking about, some of these horses now are getting huge.
Mm-hmm.
And so if that starts becoming the problem, then let's cast the horses back, and then we'll set our trees on there. And then I'll tell you, you know, if it's a medium or wide, if it's not either one of them, we're going to just put that thing back in the box, send it on to the tree maker. You're going to be, you know, a little more time, but you're going to have a saddle that works. And that tree maker, he's going to put the bars on there, and he's going to line them up on that cast. Then he's going to put everything together.
Well, it's nice to see somebody who has a passion for keeping a real art, which I guess, you know, saddle making is an art and a science, I would suspect, but keeping that all alive in these very modern, mass-produced sort of times. So are you optimistic that there are going to be people like you going forward that will carry this on?
I believe there will be, because I believe the general public is going to demand it.
There will be a market for it.
I've been at this business a long time, not necessarily making saddles, but I got my first gated horses in 1971. I was 19 years old, and I've had them.
Hey, you were ahead of the curve, man.
I was. I was at a place where we didn't have any choice. It was gated horses or walk, so we rode gated horses. And believe me, the good ones will spoil you pretty quick. But what I've seen coming up through the ages, especially since Richard Trake, John Lyons, and all these natural horse guys have come into play. The general public used to, what happened was the general public, if you had a trainer, they just told you how to think and you was like, oh, okay, you had nothing, you had no way to check these people. Right. Now people do. And now when somebody tells you something that you think or know is wrong, you got ways of verifying that. And so the general public is not as easily fooled as they used to be. So it's, I think it's going to make everybody get better in the long run.
All right. Well, thank you, my friend, for spending some time with
thank
us today.
Thank you, Rick.
And now, Nutrition Nuggets, brought to you by ADM Alliance Nutrition.
What is the real cost of feeding a horse? I'm with Dr. Judy Reynolds, equine nutritionist, ADM Alliance Nutrition. Dr. Reynolds, what does it really cost?
Well, most people are going to think about the bag of feed that they buy and consider that the most important thing for feeding the horse. It is, of course, important. But realistically, they've got a forage source. They've got either pasture or hay, and they're going to pay for that. They've also got their feed, and then most people feed, on average, 4.5 supplements from a survey. So there's a lot of money spent on that, too. So what you really want to do to get a handle on the cost of your horse feeding program is calculate the hay, weigh it out, figure out how much you feed and how much do you pay per bale. If there's a pasture situation or a rental, you know, use that, calculate it out. Then take your feed, how much is it, how much is there in each bag, and then find all the supplements that you feed and line them up and just go through and how much is each one costing you. That'll give you a good handle on your cost per day. Then what you want to do is, if you want to try to help this, and all of us do, a little extra money would be good. If you maximize the forage, try to get as many nutrients as you can from forage, and you're able to cut down to a feed that you don't have to feed as much of. Now, I don't want you to go to a poor quality feed. That's not going to help you. But if you can eliminate some supplements, like for instance, if you're feeding a vitamin mineral supplement on top of a feed, or if you're feeding just vitamin E or selenium or something like that, and you can eliminate that, that would be an extra thing that you would save some money on. Now, I'm not saying eliminate it if it's part of what your horse needs, but if you can find a feed that's already got those things in it, and then you don't have to add the supplements on top, that's the best way to go.
All right, Dr. Reynolds, thank you.
To learn more about ADM Alliance Nutrition, visit growstrong.com. That's G-R-O-strong.com.
In the coming months, Rick will appear at these events, and he'd like to meet you. Up-to-the-minute details are available at thehorseshow.com. Thehorseshow.com is also a great way to listen to Rick's radio shows or buy signed copies of his books. There's something new for horse lovers every week at thehorseshow.com.
Horses need grain.
Not true. Research has shown that equine grain-associated disorders can be a threat to domestic horses. That's why Glow for Life feeds from ADM Alliance Nutrition go against the grain with premium low-starch, high-fat, high-fiber formulations to feed horses the way they're meant to eat, for life. For a limited time, get a free customized feeding plan for your horse at growstrong.com. That's G-R-O-strong.com. Studies have shown that the higher the body temperature, the quicker an athlete reaches fatigue. That's why pro football players use protective padding that's not only shock-absorbing, but lightweight and breathable to allow heat dissipation. Now the same technology is available for your horse. Professionals Choice Air Ride saddle pads are designed with exactly the same material, which allows your horse to remain cool and performing at its maximum while effectively deflecting shock. Try the Air Ride today. Go to profchoice.com and click Rick Lamb.
When customers talk, Richie listens. And the Omni 10 automatic waterer has just what customers want. Extra size and strength, total heat coverage, large access panel, stainless steel trough, and Richie's famous fast refill valve. Like all Richie waterers, the Omni 10 is durable, reliable, and comes with a 10-year warranty. Learn more at richiefount.com. and relax. Richie waters them right.
Next week, the American Bashker Curly Horse.
It's genetics. They have a curly gene that makes them this way.
And the one thing that makes it different from all other breeds.
Their hair is actually hypoallergenic.
So have fun, ride safely, and I'll see you next time for the Horse Show here at Freedom Gaited Horse Saddle. I'm Rick Lamb.
We'd put our saddle on the horse. Usually Larry would get in it first and go, oh yeah, well, it's of course it'll do it for you. Then we put them in, let them ride the saddle around for a session. So you're talking two and a half hours. Then they go get out, they go, I gotta have one of these saddles. And so they go look at our displays, and we'd have one out there with a hard seat, and they go, oh gosh, I couldn't ride that thing.
But isn't that what they were riding?
Yeah, and we go, well, you just been in one for 2 hours, and they go, oh no. And go, oh yeah, go back. And they wouldn't believe us. They would go back and look.
Closed captioning is presented by Muddy Creek Rain Gear, lightweight, breathable, and truly waterproof. Visit muddycreek.net.